magnetic, wasn't he? He just had everything.
Dennis Law, there praised by Jimmy Greaves, and following it, the commentary of one of his...
Dennis Law was my favourite player of all time. He was the most wonderful footballer. Great goal scorer, great player. I mean, he was magnetic, wasn't he? He just had everything.
Dennis Law, there praised by Jimmy Greaves, and following it, the commentary of one of his famous goals. Quicksilver with an eye for goal, Dennis was born in Aberdeen 57 years ago, where the round ball game was his only recreation as a boy.
In those days, football was the only thing that you did anyway. I know down in England, of course, they played cricket in the summer, but in Scotland, they just played football all the year round. The guy next door was obviously a bit well off because he had two pairs of boots, and my first pair of boots I got was his second-hand ones, which were handed on. You probably remember them as well, with that strap over, you know what I mean? You couldn't lace the boots, you know, they were like brick hard, you had to steep them and all that sort of thing. But it was my first pair of boots. Playing football was, well, you didn't know anything else. That is all you did. You played football on your way to school with an old tennis ball, because nobody could afford a ball anyway. And back home at night, of course, no television. I used to have the, what do we call it, the pulley for the clothes, taken up to the roof, you know, the ceiling.
Oh, yes.
So what I used to do, I used to tie a ball of wool, or rags or whatever, into a sort of shape of a ball, and then hang it down and then swing it around to see where I could kick it so it didn't hit anything in the kitchen. And I used to practice for hours just kicking it with my left and my right. And then later on, of course, I used to raise it up and then practice heading this bag of rags or whatever it was. And because that was all I was to do.
Well, it worked. Dennis became a Scottish schoolboy international, but of course he was desperate to be a professional player. Although the first call for his services came rather surprisingly from West Yorkshire.
I was asked to go down to Huddersfield for a trial. This was a guy called Archie Beattie, who was the brother of Andy Beattie, who was then the manager of Huddersfield Town. And the only reason he had a scout there, because it was his brother, lived up the road, and he obviously saw something. What I really wanted to do was to be an architect. That was my forte at school. I was good at maths and I was good at technical drawing. Went down with my two brothers. You know, they must have liked what they'd seen, because they then said, would you like to go on the ground? Which made no sense to me at all. It was just part and parcel.
Had you ever been to England before?
Never. I hadn't been out of Aberdeen.
So, what did you think when you arrived in Huddersfield?
Oh, awful. Awful. Because don't forget, if you know Aberdeen, it is a beautiful city. I mean, it's all granite. It's on the beach. It's got the harbour. To go down to a place like Huddersfield, not recommended, because it was all mills. They made all the cloth. And to see Huddersfield after Aberdeen, no, I was homesick. I was homesick for about 5 years, actually. When I went back home, I never wanted to go back to Huddersfield.
You used to have a player for the town, I believe.
Well, I got into the team when I was 16, which was, yes, very young. Also, a guy had made his debut before me, a guy called Kevin McHale.
Yes.
And, of course, it was five forwards in those days. It was outside right, inside, you know, etc. And we formed the youngest ever in the Football League. So it was two 16-year-olds on the right wing for Huddersfield Town. So, yes, I was very young. Didn't think anything of it. I played in the reserves. It's like your ambition, isn't it? You've been at the club for a year and a bit. It was your ambition to be in the first team, but I never thought it would come that early.
And you changed managers as well, didn't you?
Shankly, of course. Andy Beattie left the club for what reason, I can't remember, I think. Shanks has been his number two for a wee while prior to that, and then...
What was Shanks like in those days and before he got to Liverpool?
He was exactly the same. Shanks never changed from the day I met him when I was a 15, 16-year-old boy till the day he died. We always wondered where Huddersfield would have went had Shanks been given the money. He went to buy players. He went to buy Big Ron Yates, I think he played for Dundee United then, and the Saints. But Huddersfield either didn't have the money or they didn't give him the money. Because we had a good team in those days. We had Ray Wilson, who obviously became the left-back of the England World Cup team. We had Gordon Lowe, we had Kevin McHale, Les Massey. We had a basis of a very good side. And unfortunately for Huddersfield, they decided to let Shanks go, and of course went to Liverpool. And Liverpool, we had played Liverpool about 3 weeks before at Huddersfield and beat them 5-1. And of course, Shanks called Liverpool everything. And of course, 3 weeks later, he'd gone there and they were the greatest team in the world.
Well, the young Dennis Law scored 18 goals in 81 games for Huddersfield, but clearly they were never going to be able to hold on to such a talent.
I honestly thought that I would go with Shanks to Liverpool.
Did he try to take you with him?
He did. And again, like Huddersfield prior to that, they didn't have the money, because we were now talking about a lot of money, something like £55,000. They were second division, and yes, they didn't have the money.
But it was the British record.
It was. It was one of those, there was talks of two or three clubs, and I really fancied Arsenal. They were the club. And they sent up their assistant manager, I think it was. And I thought, well, that's sort of order, that, really. The guy sent the manager up.
Did that turn you against Arsenal, the fact that the manager... Who was the manager at the time, can you remember?
Now, I'm just trying to think of the manager, James.
George Swindon?
George Swindon, correct. And, of course, Arsenal were a huge club. Oh, yeah. Well, you couldn't get any bigger.
Yeah.
That's where I fancied going. But after that, I thought... And then, of course, I met Les McDowell. And I think the fact that he was Scottish as well, and also it was just across the Pennines, it didn't take much persuading, because I'd already watched Manchester City in the FA Cup in 55. It was the first game I'd ever seen live on telly. And then in 56, of course, when they won it. They were having a bit of a bad time, but they were a big club. And I came over and I thoroughly enjoyed my time in Manchester City.
But it was only a short time, though, wasn't it? We won here, roughly, just over?
Well, it was. Don't forget, it was the maximum wage was in those days. And all of a sudden, Italy came into the equation. Big John Charles had gone there a few years previous. And, you know, a young boy, didn't know anything at all, but when you think you could five times your wages or whatever.
Yeah, was it that tempted you?
Oh, yes, of course.
Can you remember what your wage was at Manchester City?
I think it was £20. The maximum wage had just been abolished when I went to Italy.
That's why we're still poor, is it?
Yeah, correct. So it was an experience. Thoroughly enjoyed my time in Italy, other than the football.
What was wrong?
Well, the football was so defensive. Every result basically was 0-0, 1-0, 0-1. If a team scored, then the other team, you just defended. Torino, we played the same way. We would mark their dangerous men and then just defend and hope we'd score a goal, and that was it. Everything else about the place was lovely, but the football was awful. Had it been like, as it has been this last few years, if it had been like that in my time, I would have probably never come back.
Well, just like Jimmy Greaves, Dennis never really settled in Italy, although the fans at Torino did like him. And in the end, he was rescued by another Scot, Matt Busby, who paid a British record of £115,000 for him. And it was in this era at Manchester United up to 1973 where he played his best football alongside Bobby Charlton and George Best.
Choice of clubs has got to be limited. But when I knew that Manchester United were coming in, I'd already lived in Manchester. I knew Busby. I knew that they were going to try and rebuild the team up. You know, he'd already bought a few players. I knew they were a great side in 47 or 48, around that time, and I knew they, obviously, the Busby Babes. So I knew I was coming back to a guy who, as a manager, had a proven record, and I knew I was coming to a place that I knew I liked there, because I'd enjoyed my year at Manchester City.
Within a year, you'd won the Cup, and you had a couple of championships in the 60s as well.
Right.
Is that the best club side you played in, do you think?
Oh, yes, without a doubt, yeah.
And it wasn't just Lord Best and Charlton, was
not
it?
Not at all.
Without being
not at all.
You've condescending got to other players.
You've got to have a squad of players, just that maybe sometimes the ones who score the goals get a bigger press or whatever. But no, you've got to have a bit. We had Nobby Styles. We couldn't have done without Nobby Styles. We had Pat Crennan. Couldn't have done without Pat. Bill Fuchs, of course, who was a staunch player at the back. Two full-backs, Shea Brennan, Tony Dunn, Alex Stepney in goal. No, there was a whole stack of players. You got to have a squad of players to have a good side.
Get the disappointment of the European Cup final, of course, when you didn't play. Is that one of your biggest ever disappointments?
Well, it was. But fortunately, or unfortunately, you know, I had been injured before the final. If I'd been injured in the semi-final and missed it through that, I'd have been devastated. But I knew well in advance that I wasn't going to be playing in it. But I thought, we're such a good team anyway, we should have won it 2 years before. And then again, after when we came back, we should have won it again. You know, when I scored against Milan at Old Trafford to equalise, it was about 2 feet over the line, and the referee didn't give the goal. That would have been the equaliser, and we would have beat Milan, who then played Ajax in the final. So, although at the time, Jim, it is disappointing, you just felt that we were such a good team, we could win it again. We could win it for the next 2 or 3 years, with a bit of luck.
I've always had this theory about teams getting to European Cup finals, that you've got to have what I call European know-how.
Mm.
Do you think that's what's just holding us up a little bit at the moment?
Oh, I do. I think the fact that we were out of Europe for a few years, 5 years, haven't we? You know, it's taken a little bit of time to come back because you missed that competition. It's like in the early days of Europe. You know, you played your football here, you went over to, I don't know, Bratislava or whatever. You were trying to play...
Can you remember what your wage was at Manchester City?
I think it was £20. But the maximum wage had just been abolished when I went to Italy.
That's why we're still poor, is it?
Yeah, correct. So it was an experience. Thoroughly enjoyed my time in Italy, other than the football.
What was wrong?
Well, the football was so defensive. Every result basically was 0-0, 1-0, 0-1. If a team scored, then the other team, you just defended. Torino, we played the same way. We would mark their dangerous men and then just defend and hope we'd score a goal. And that was it. Everything else about the place was lovely, but the football was awful. Had it been like, as it has been this last few years, if it had been like that in my time, I would have probably never come back.
Well, just like Jimmy Greaves, Dennis never really settled in Italy, although the fans at Torino did like him. And in the end, he was rescued by another Scot, Matt Busby, who paid a British record of £115,000 for him. And it was in this era at Manchester United up to 1973 where he played his best football alongside Bobby Charlton and George Best.
Choice of clubs has got to be limited. But when I knew that Manchester United were coming in, I'd already lived in Manchester. I knew Busby. I knew that they were going to try and rebuild the team up. You know, he'd already bought a few players. I knew they were a great side in 47 or 48, around that time, and I knew they, obviously, the Busby Babes. So I knew I was coming back to a guy who, as a manager, had a proven record, and I knew I was coming to a place that I knew I liked there because I'd enjoyed.
He was magnetic, wasn't he? He just had everything.
Dennis Law, there praised by Jimmy Greaves, and following it, the commentary of one of his...
Dennis Law was my favourite player of all time. He was the most wonderful footballer. Great goal scorer, great player. I mean, he was magnetic, wasn't he? He just had everything.
Dennis Law, there praised by Jimmy Greaves, and following it, the commentary of one of his famous goals. Quicksilver with an eye for goal, Dennis was born in Aberdeen 57 years ago, where the round ball game was his only recreation as a boy.
In those days, football was the only thing that you did anyway. I know down in England, of course, they played cricket in the summer, but in Scotland, they just played football all the year round. The guy next door was obviously a bit well off because he had two pairs of boots, and my first pair of boots I got was his second-hand ones, which were handed down. You probably remember them as well, with that strap over, you know, I mean, you couldn't lace the boots, you know, they were like brick hard, you had to steep them and all that sort of thing, but it was my first pair of boots. Playing football was, well, you didn't know anything else, that is all you did. You played football on your way to school with an old tennis ball, because nobody could afford a ball anyway. And back home at night, of course, no television. I used to have the, what do we call it, the pulley for the clothes, taken up to the roof, you know, the ceiling.
Oh, yes.
So what I used to do, I used to tie a ball of wool, or rags or whatever, into a sort of shape of a ball, and then hang it down, and then swing it around to see where I could kick it, so it didn't hit anything in the kitchen. And I used to practice for hours, just kicking it with my left and my right. And then later on, of course, I used to raise it up and then practice heading this bag of rags of right inside, you know, etc. And we formed the youngest ever in the Football League. So it was 2 16-year-olds on the right wing for Huddersfield Town. So, yes, I was very young. Didn't think anything of it. I played in the reserves. It's like your ambition is that you've been at the club for a year and a bit. It was your ambition to be in the first team, but I never thought it would come that early.
And you changed managers as well, didn't you?
Shankly, of course, Andy Beattie left the club for what reason, I can't remember, I think. Shanks has been his number two for a wee while prior to that, and then...
Of course, Shanks liked him those days and before he got to Liverpool.
He was exactly the same. Shanks never changed from the day I met him when I was a 15, 16-year-old boy till the day he died. We always wondered where Huddersfield would have went had Shanks been given the money. He went to buy players. He went to buy Big Ron Yates, I think he played for Dundee United then, and the Saints. But Huddersfield either didn't have the money or they didn't give him the money. Because we had a good team in those days. We had Ray Wilson, who obviously became the left-back of the England World Cup team. We had Gordon Lowe, we had Kevin McHale, Les Massey. We had a basis of a very good side. And unfortunately for Huddersfield, they decided to let Shanks go and, of course, went to Liverpool. And Liverpool, we had played Liverpool about 3 weeks before at Huddersfield and beat them 5-1. And of course, Shanks called Liverpool everything. And of course, 3 weeks later, he'd gone there and they were the greatest team in the world.
Well, the young Dennis Law scored 18 goals in 81 games for Huddersfield, but clearly they were never going to be able to hold on to such a talent.
Whatever it was. And because that was all there was to do.
Well, it worked. Dennis became a Scottish schoolboy international, but of course he was desperate to be a professional player. Although the first call for his services came rather surprisingly from West Yorkshire.
I was asked to go down to Huddersfield for a trial. This was a guy called Archie Beattie, who was the brother of Andy Beattie, who was then the manager of Huddersfield Town. And the only reason he had a scout there because it was his brother lived up the road, and he obviously saw something. What I really wanted to do was to be an architect. That was my forte at school. I was good at maths and I was good at technical drawing. Went down with my two brothers. You know, they must have liked what they'd seen, because they then said, would you like to go underground? Which made no sense to me at all. It was just part and parcel.
Had you ever been to England before?
Never. I hadn't been out of Aberdeen.
So, what did you think when you arrived in Huddersfield?
Oh, awful. Awful. Because don't forget, if you know Aberdeen, it is a beautiful city. I mean, it's all granite. It's on the beach. It's got the harbour. To go down to a place like Huddersfield, not recommended, because it was all mills. They made all the cloth. And to see Huddersfield after Aberdeen, no, I was homesick. I was homesick for about 5 years, actually. When I went back home, I never wanted to go back to Huddersfield.
You used to have a player for the town, I believe.
Well, I got into the team when I was 16, which was, yes, very young. Also, a guy had made his debut before me, a guy called Kevin McHale.
Yes.
And, of course, it was five forwards in those days. It was outside. I honestly thought that I would go with Shanks to Liverpool.
Did he try to take you with him?
He did. And again, like Huddersfield prior to that, they didn't have the money, because we were now talking about a lot of money, something like £55,000. They were second division, and yes, they didn't have the money.
But it was the British record.
It was. It was one of those, there was talks of two or three clubs, and I really fancied Arsenal. They were the club. And they sent up their assistant manager, I think it was. And I thought, well, that's sort of order, that, really. They can't send the manager up.
Did that turn you against Arsenal? Who was the manager at the time? Can you remember?
Now, I'm just trying to think of the manager, James.
George Swindon?
George Swindon, correct. And, of course, Arsenal were a huge club.
Oh, yeah.
Well, you couldn't get any bigger.
Yeah.
That's where I fancied going. But after that, I thought... And then, of course, I met Les McDowell. And I think the fact that he was Scottish as well, and also, it was just across the Pennines, it didn't take much persuading, because I'd already watched Manchester City in the FA Cup in 55. It was the first game I'd ever seen live on telly. And then in 56, of course, when they won it, they were having a bit of a bad time, but they were a big club. And I came over and I thoroughly enjoyed my time in Manchester City.
But it was only a short time, though, wasn't it? We won the year, roughly, just over?
Well, it was. Don't forget, it was the maximum wage was in those days. And all of a sudden, Italy came into the equation. Big John Charles had gone there a few years previous. And, you know, a young boy, didn't know anything at all, but when you think you could five times your wages or whatever.
Yeah, was it that tempted you?
Oh, yes, of course.